and welcome to Arts and Entertainment. I'm Deborah Gilbert, your host. So glad to see you today, and thanks so much for taking time out of your busy day. Well, we have a great show for you today, as we always do. We're going to talk about the Connecticut Office of the Arts, which is based in the state of Connecticut. And I have a great guest for us today. It's Elizabeth Shapiro. And let me read you her full title, because you'll want to get to know all about her. She is the Director of Arts Preservation and Museums for the Connecticut Office of the Arts and State Historic Preservation Office, the Department of Economic and Community Development for the state of Connecticut. And Liz, thank you so very much for being with us today. I really appreciate it.
You're very welcome. It's my pleasure.
Well, I know that's a very long title, which I encountered in your email, and I love it. It makes you incredibly important, which also says to my viewers that we're going to get a lot of wonderful information today from you, and I'm thrilled about that.
Well, anything I can answer, I'm willing to try.
Well, why don't we take the viewer back? Let's talk about you and your background. Tell us about yourself.
Well, that's a broad question. So, I have been in Connecticut for the past 20 odd years, almost 25 years now. And I spent most of my career in the northwest corner of Connecticut, in Sharon, Connecticut, and Salisbury, Connecticut. And my job when I was living up there was running the Sharon Historical Society. After doing that for about 19 years and raising my children in that area, I took a job as the director of the Connecticut League of History Organizations, which was based in Middletown. And that organization is really the professional association for people working in historical societies and other history-related organizations in the state. And from there, I was lucky enough to move to the Department of Economic and Community Development in 2017 in June, to take on the role of the Director of Historic Preservation and Museums. And then I was fortunate to be in the right place at the right time when my predecessor left, and I was able to become the director of our division, which is Arts, Historic Preservation, and Museums.
Did you know growing up or into adulthood that this was going to be the journey, pathway, work way that you were going to pursue?
Actually, you know, yes, which is a little strange, I think. I grew up on Long Island, so I'm a transplant to Connecticut, but my parents were both extremely interested in history, and we used to play Trivial Pursuit as a family when I was a kid, when it first came out, and my parents could just knock the history category out of the park. All of our family vacations were spent being cultural tourists. We didn't have the phrase cultural tourism when I was growing up, but that's what we did. So we visited lots and lots of forts and historic sites all across the country and in other countries as well. And so I grew up used to going to museums. When I was in college outside of Philadelphia, I was at a small college, and one of the things they advised students who were entering their sophomore year was to potentially get an off-campus volunteer job, just so the world didn't get too small for them. And I took a volunteer job at the Academy of Natural Sciences in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, which is the Museum of Natural History there. And it was really within 6 months I went from being a volunteer to manage their hands-on nature center, which was in the facility called Outside In. And then I went to assisting overnight program at the museum. And then I started running that program. And that was all while I was in college. So by that time, I firmly knew that I wanted to be working within the cultural sphere. And so I directed my career to museums. And I attended the Cooperstown graduate program and got a master's degree in history museum studies, which a lot of people think is what? Like, is that even possible? I'm here to tell you that it's possible.
With regards to history museums, is that more of the direction that you wanted to take? I know that you're in the Office of the Arts. How do the two mix together?
So I think it's really a combination of vocation and avocation. So from where I landed in college and from the Academy of Natural Sciences, I decided I wanted to work in museums. But I have been a performer all of my life. So from a very early age, I was an actor and a singer, a vocalist, and participated in many community, not just community choirs, but in productions. Never as a professional, but always as a very, very highly dedicated and an excited amateur. Most recently, and this is very sad for me to say because most recently is quite a long time ago, I sang with the Light Opera Company of Salisbury, Connecticut, which is called Locos. So that was my background was really firmly in the arts, but I also had this other history piece. So really what happened was, you know, you land where you land in terms of your career. And I was very excited doing the work that I was doing. But when I was able to transition and to working with the arts community again, it felt very familiar and like I was coming back to a place where I belonged.
Did you feel along the way as a performer that that would be your journey instead of where you are now? Do you have any regrets?
You know, that's a great question. And I wish I could say yes, but I don't. So I never felt as much, you know, I was the kid who, with a couple of friends of mine, we would cut school when we were in high school on Wednesdays. And, but instead of like going to play hooky and sleeping late, we would get on a train and go to New York City and stand online to get discount tickets to see a Broadway show. So at one point I thought, boy, that would be great. But there's lots of other aspects of my personality that made me sort of decide that this was not the kind, that was not the career for me. It was not a good match for really what I wanted to achieve in my life. And boy, the competition is stiff and you have to have some kind of a hard shell to be able to make it in the world of entertainment.
Well, it's interesting you should say that. I'll throw myself in that ring. I grew up as an actor in musical theater and had pursued an acting career in New York City. And it was such stiff competition and so much against the grain of trying to make it that I decided that I was much better being myself than somebody else and started pursuing being an interviewer on cable television, radio, and the internet. Mm-hmm. So I kind of made a transition as well. I kind of feel exactly what you're talking about. How did you find yourself at the Council of the Arts? What is it all about anyway?
Well, as I mentioned, when I started work for the state in 2017, I was only very peripherally involved in the arts part of our program. So we are located within the Department of Economic and Community Development. And, you know, state agencies morph and change over years. And originally, the Office of the Arts, the Arts Council, the Arts Commission is what it was known, was an independent state agency. And then they merged with tourism and became the Division of Culture, the agency that was called Culture and Tourism. And then not too long ago, 7-8 years ago, they became a part of the Department of Economic and Community Development. And so when I got to DECD, I was in an agency that was focused on economic development and running museums and working on historic preservation issues for the most part. But my boss was wonderful and she really let me be involved with the art side of things. And then after a year, she left and her position. And so I was able to act as interim. And I will say that I really found, you know, that transition to be terrific. The Office of the Arts is very much the service organization for the arts in the state of Connecticut. We are what's known as a state arts agency, and we are partnered with the National Endowment for the Arts, and we receive funding from the National Endowment for the Arts, which is matched by funding from the state of Connecticut. So we're a service organization. We serve artists and we serve arts organizations. We do professional development, counseling. We offer a whole lot of grants. So our programs are really, really wide. We also have an arts council that is sort of a little bit of an overarching governing body, and they are recognized in state statute. And with the Arts Council, we look at what is happening in trends in the arts and in arts funding across the United States. And we do our best to incorporate those trends and be on the cutting edge of what's happening across the United States for our Connecticut artists and arts organizations.
Okay, let's hold that thought. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back.
So you think you're safe in your COVID bubble, huh? You don't wear your mask because you're around each other all the time and you trust each other. If only it were that simple. Let's say you go over to your neighbor's house. That's okay, right? They're in your bubble. But your neighbor goes to work and has a coworker that doesn't wear a mask over his nose. And that coworker has a family and grown children that also go to work. Your neighbor also has a close relative who goes to bonfires at another friend's house regularly, where everyone is close together but don't wear masks because they're outside, and they all have families and coworkers. That's just your neighbor. That doesn't include your neighbor's neighbors, or your sister, your aunt, your best friend, or even your dad. The point is, everyone you know has a network. Everyone in their network has a network, and it only grows from there. So when you think you're hanging out with just 10 people, you're really hanging out with 100, 500, maybe 1,000. We'd hate to burst your bubble, but you don't have one. So think twice before venturing out. Keep your guard and your mask up whenever you're around anyone who doesn't live in your immediate household, even if they're trusted family or friends. That's the best way to stay safe and healthy.
Welcome back to Arts and Entertainment. I'm Deborah Gilbert, your host. We're talking about the Connecticut Office of the Arts with Elizabeth Shapiro. And Liz, thanks again for being here. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
You know, I talked to so many performers and so many organizations and museums, et cetera, and the one thing that's always coming up is COVID. How is your arena doing with the pandemic?
Our arena has been challenged. It's been an unbelievably difficult time for not only Connecticut artists, but Connecticut arts organizations. We have, you know, the arts in Connecticut is a $9 billion industry. We bring a lot of money into the state of Connecticut. And right now, the state's restrictions have been implemented. Live theaters and live concert venues have had to be dark. Most of our other arts organizations, schools and studios, have also had to curtail their activities. So artists who are often employed by these arts organizations or who are used to serving their clients in public, either by art shows or by teaching art or, you know, in other ways, they have really, really been hurt by the pandemic. But I will tell you that I have seen such amazing resilience among this community. Arts organizations, you know, so many of them have been able to pivot and become experts at working in a virtual space, which is not something that, you know, as an artist, we're used to doing because we so value the idea that we are in person, you know, that live and in person. But, you know, when you're an orchestra, you can't be on stage performing. You can't be playing instruments. When you're in musical theater, that's another thing you can't be doing. If you're teaching, if you're running an art school, you know, we couldn't have children next to each other interacting for the whole beginning of this pandemic. So it has been a very, very hard time. But I really believe that the arts have been at the center of the people's ability to process what is happening around them. And indeed, they have made art and continued to make art that will help them heal through this time.
Does the Office of the Arts financially help the artists' organizations, if you will, or the performers through the state at all? Where does your funding come from?
So we give out about $2 million, a little more every year, depending on what our state allocation is. We get about between $750,000 and $800,000 from the National Endowment for the Arts in our role as state arts agencies. We can only fund nonprofit organizations. We can fund artists, but we can only fund them for project purposes using our federal dollars. We have a little bit more flexibility with our state dollars. So this year we have given out so many grants and we have had to pivot, and we have been able to pivot very successfully, I think, under the circumstances. So we, in April and May, we were able to quickly take the resources that we had from the end of our fiscal year 2020 and create Artist Relief Fund and an Artist Respond Fund. And the Relief Fund were grants that were given to artists who just needed to have some financial support in order to keep the lights on in their homes and to keep food on their table. And we did that in partnership with the New England Foundation for the Arts. And for that, we are really grateful. We had never been able to do that before. Artist Respond Funds, we use state and federal funds to fund projects that artists submitted a very simple application to do that were in some way responsive to what we were seeing happening in the pandemic. So some were to bring virtual programs to elderly housing complexes. Some were to continue doing classroom work virtually with students who had visual impairments. But it really ran the gamut. A lot of storytelling and a lot of trying to create hands-on projects in a virtual format, which is really tricky. But we also fund organizations. So our biggest pot of funding that we offer is the Supporting Arts Program. And those are basic operating support grants for arts organizations. If anyone is out there and listening and is affiliated with an arts organization that is a 501c3, I would encourage you to go to our website. If you just search Connecticut Office of the Arts, that will bring you there, and it will talk a lot about our grants programs. We have an endowment program that is a statutory program where we are able to offer basic operating or general operating support. Unfortunately, the funding we have never meets the demand. So we have always been forced to allocate what we can, but it is rarely, we are rarely able to fill the full grant amounts that we have requests for. But I also want to give a shout out to Governor Lamont and to the commissioner of the DEC, Commissioner David Layman. This year, due in part to their hard work and their support of arts and culture, we were able to give out $9 million, which is an unprecedented amount of funding, to about 154 arts organizations who have basically had to remain closed due to pandemic restrictions. And then an additional $1.5 million to the Connecticut Humanities Council, who was able to re-grant those funds to museums and humanities-based organizations who are also suffering.
You mentioned the website, and I do want to talk about it for a second. What will the viewer or someone find when they do arrive at the website?
Well, the first thing I want to say is that it's a state website. The state of Connecticut has a website that is used and maintained for all of the state agencies. So we do have some limitations about how easy it is to use our website. However, if you search Connecticut Office of the Arts, what you will be able to find are funding opportunities. You'll be able to find out about the artist fellowship programs that we run, about our state troubadour program and the state poet laureate program, about awards that we give to recognize individuals, who need to have professional development work. Those are the Elizabeth McAfee Scholarship. So we do have a scholarship program. You'll also be able to find out a whole lot about resources for arts organizations and artists and COVID-19 through the pandemic. And you'll also be able to get a list of our 9 designated regional service organizations. Those are our feet on the street in different regions of Connecticut. And for most people, because our staff is quite small, we have 4 program managers, a grants manager, and me, but I also run 4 museums and the Office of Historic Preservation, you'll be able to go to your designated regional service organization, and they can be a point of entry into the programs at the Office of the Arts. So I'm really, really proud of the partnership that we have with them.
Now I am seeing you, I believe, in your home. Is your staff working from home due to COVID? How are things going in your office?
So we have all been working from home since the middle of March, March 17th, and I actually had to go out a little bit earlier because I had a possible exposure. So I think staff, we are able to go into the office for short periods of time. I have been in four times since March, but I have also been out to our museums each a couple of times. We have become experts in Zoom meetings, and the state actually uses Microsoft Teams. We hold a lot of meetings, and I like to look at COVID from COVID deficit and COVID abundance. And COVID deficit means we can't go to plays and restaurants, and there's so many things we can't do, but I like to dwell in COVID abundance in that space. And that is that there are so many opportunities that we have access to now virtually. There's so much competition with wonderful materials for our time. There's so much ability to get on programs like this and to talk to people. And I can honestly say that my staff and I have created more new partnerships since COVID hit than we would probably have been able to create in the normal course of business where we were having our sort of normal runaround days. So we miss being together terribly, and we miss seeing our colleagues across the state, but we do see each other virtually quite a bit.
What does the future look like as the pandemic hopefully rolls out of our world and things get back to normal and you get back in your office? How do you see the arts progressing as we get into 21-22?
I think the arts are going to come back with a vengeance. Arts organizations and artists have been at work this whole time. They are poised and waiting for the ability to reopen. And I think what we're going to see is our arts organizations really looking and helping people make sense of these multiple pandemics that we have faced, this incredible health crisis, the crisis of racial equity, the crisis of environmental equity, and our political situation. And I believe that the arts are going to be the bridge that are going to lead us across to a place of healing, which is so sorely needed in this country. I am truly optimistic.
What should somebody do that's listening now, the viewer, et cetera, from an arts organization? How do they get involved with your office? What should they be doing to move forward to become what they would like to become?
That's a great question. So what the first thing I would advise is hit our website and subscribe to our newsletter, our e-blast. We are not on a regular schedule because we don't want to bombard you, but when we have information, especially if it's timely, we share it. We've also partnered with FEMA Region 1 to present a series of webinars about how organizations can get through helping folks specifically in Connecticut navigate this pandemic and all of these crises. Those are recorded and they are available on our website. So those are the first two things. I would then take a look at the designated regional service organization list, which is under the Our Partners tab on our website. And if you are not working with your designated regional service organization, please reach out and connect with them because they are really your ambassador to the Office of the Arts. That said, me and all of my staff, and we are all listed on the website, are always happy to talk to anybody who has questions for us and who is struggling or who is not struggling. We love to share success stories. And I can tell you that I am on camera quite a bit. I have two more interviews that I'm doing this week. And I am very available to come and speak to a group of arts organizations, virtually. So reach out if you feel like you need a pep talk or if there's any way that the Office of the Arts can be more helpful.
You've been wonderful to spend time with us today. I greatly appreciate it. We have run out of time.
It went really quickly, and I so appreciate this.
Well, thank you so much for being here today. I'm Deborah Gilbert. You've been tuned into Arts and Entertainment. Thanks so much for being here. I'll see you next time.